Hey guys, my name is Joe Hemphill. I'm one of the staff members here at Christ for the Nations Church. And here at Christ for the Nations, our mission and our desire is to disciple the church to reach the nations for Jesus Christ. We believe that one of the best ways to do that is through community and relationship. This right here is a resource for you guys if you weren't able to be with us this past Sunday for whatever reason. But we believe that this isn't a replacement for the local church. So if you're in the Nashville area, we would love to have you come out at 10 a.m. on Sundays to worship with us at one of our gatherings. Also, if you'd like to get more information or get connected with Christ for the Nations Church, you can go to our website at www.thenations.church. You can also sign up for our weekly email there, and you can kind of find out what's been going on here at the church. With that being said, guys, this past week was Easter, and we had an amazing time celebrating the resurrection of Jesus with each other. And guys, I'm excited for you to hear what Ray had to say about the victory we have in the resurrection.
1 Corinthians 15, beginning in verse 50. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying, as it is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brother, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is what?
Not in vain.
Let's pray this morning. Father, thank you for the beautiful words of song. Thank you that they point us to the cross of Christ. Thank you that they not only point us to the cross of Christ, but they point us to the victory of the resurrection. And so this morning, on this day that we celebrate your glorious resurrection from the dead, we just acknowledge that we need you in such profound ways. And so this morning, I ask that you would help rein in my heart and my soul and my mind to speak the words that you would have me to speak. I pray that as we listen to your words, it would not just be mundane, ho-hum, I've heard that before. I already know that. I pray that it would really just arrest us, change us, meet us in places where we have hidden from you, that the gospel of your truth would free us. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. This is a glorious Sunday. I don't know about you, but this is how every Sunday should be. Really, every day. But on Sunday, we get to gather just to say we are incredibly blessed to be a part of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. There's a hymn called Tell the Old, Old Story. I don't know, some of you hymn lovers may have heard of that, Tell the Old, Old Story. And it is an old story, but it's never old. And what I don't want us to do is to approach this gospel in a sense of, we know this, but to apply it in our lives in a way like never before. I want to ask you this morning, what are you afraid of? What is it that causes fear in your life? Somebody said bugs. That has to be my family. Psychology Today says a simple definition of fear is an anxious feeling caused by our anticipation of some imagined event or experience. Medical experts tell us that the anxious feeling we get when we're afraid is standardized biological reaction. It's pretty much the same set of body signals whether you're afraid of getting bitten by a dog, or getting turned down for a date, or getting our taxes audited. I'm feeling that already. Fear, like all other emotions, is basically information. So says Psychology Today. We all have fears. I don't know if you know what the top five fears or phobias are in the world. One is arachnophobia. That's a fear of what?
Spiders.
Hope I can say this one. Ophidiophobia. Fear of snakes. I said that one just for Randy, but that is the second fear. Acrophobia, a fear of heights. Agoraphobia, it's a fear of situations where escape is difficult. Claustrophobia. I had no idea that I suffered from that at all until I had an MRI. And I thought it was no big deal. And I'm going in for the MRI, I'm laying there. And I made the mistake once I was in this graveyard tomb thing. I opened my eyes and my body reacted. It was not pleasant. I was like, if I don't get out of here, I'm going to be like the Hulk and totally destroy this thing. So I said in a very calm voice, you need to back me out. And they said, what'd you say? I said, I need a moment. And I remember realizing, wow, I have a fear of that. And then there's cynophobia. That's a fear of dogs, or cynophobia. I'm not sure how you pronounce it. A fear of dogs. You know, there's five core fears that are universal. No matter where you live, what country you are from, this captures the basic premise of humanity. These are the top fears. Number one, a fear of abandonment, being left alone. There's the fear of the loss of identity. The loss of identity. Three, the loss of meaning. Fear, I don't have meaning in this life. What is this all about? Number four, a loss of purpose. A loss of purpose. And when people have a loss of purpose, many times they see no reason to continue on. Can you guess what the top fear is? But I left it for number five. You know what that is? The fear of death. The fear of death, which would include the fear of how you die. Because some people say, well, I'm not afraid to die, but it's the process. It's that fear of sickness, the fear of pain. Right up there with the fear of death is the fear of public speaking. I don't understand that, but people, I don't equate speaking publicly and death, but there are those, they would rather die. There's several verses I want you to listen to this morning. And I want you to tell me what they have in common. Psalm 49, verses 8 through 10. For the ransom of their life is costly and can never suffice, that he should live on forever and never see the pit. For he sees that even the wise do what? The fool and the stupid alike must perish and leave their wealth to others. Good morning. Psalm 89, verse 48. What man can live and never see death? Who can deliver his soul from the power of Sheol? Ecclesiastes. I'm going to read several from Ecclesiastes. I love this. This is the preacher that has lived his life. This is Solomon, who had everything imaginable under the sun. This is the man who had many wives, concubines. He would bring snow from the mountains in order to have ice water. This man had everything you could ever think of, and he says this in Ecclesiastes 2. Then I said in my heart, what happens to the fool will also happen to me also. Why then have I been so very wise? And I said in my heart, this also is vanity. For the wise For of the wise as of the fool, there is no enduring remembrance, seeing that in the days to come, all will have been long forgotten. How the wise dies just like the fool. Ecclesiastes 3:19, for what happens to the children of man and what happens to the beast is the same. As one dies, so dies the other. They all have the same breath, and man has no advantage over beast, for all is vanity. Ecclesiastes 8:8, no man has power to retain the spirit or power over the day of death. There is no discharge from war, nor will wickedness deliver those who are given to it. Let me just read two more, because I think you get the point. Ecclesiastes 9:5, for the living know that they will what? They will die, but the dead know nothing, and they have no reward, for their memory of them is forgotten. He's a very positive guy, isn't he? Romans 5:14, yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who are sinning, was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. What do all these verses have in common? Death, and what else about death?
Certainty.
The certainty of death. If you're full, you're going to die.
Yes, sir.
If you're wise, you're going to die. If you're rich, you're going to
die.
See, I didn't want you to think that even most of us are rich according to the world.
Yeah.
You're going to die. If you're poor, you're going to die. This is a reality. A lot of people fear this. And my first point this morning, this is the reality of our humanity. This is the reality of our humanity, death. I was thinking about this. I heard a sermon, and it prompted this in my mind as well. When Adam and Eve, before they sinned, God told them not to eat of the fruit. But if they did eat of this particular fruit, they would do what? They would die. They would certainly die. Now, after they had eaten of the fruit, it says that Adam and Eve knew that they were naked, and they did what? They hid themselves because they were what? They were afraid. Think about it. Why was Adam afraid? Now, don't say because he sinned. We know that. But why was he afraid? Because he knew that they weren't supposed to sin. That's exactly right. So what's behind that? What else? Why do you think they were afraid? What did God say would happen to them? You're going to die. Could it be that they were afraid God was going to come right down and just strike them dead? Because God had told them, the day that you eat the fruit thereof, you will surely die. And so when he thought he was going to die, he was afraid. That is the human plight. We never get used to death because it's not meant to be this way. When we moved to Nashville, Tennessee, in a 10-year period, we lost 8 of our loved ones that we loved. 8. And those of you who have been with us, you know all the funerals from aunts, cousins, our parents. We lost all 4 of our parents. All of this happened in a 10-year period. And let me tell you, I never get used to it. I'm on call right now because I have a cousin who's like a brother to me. We grew up together. And he's dying of cancer. And I get the opportunity of going to Kansas City to see him Tuesday, Lord willing, before he passes away, so that we can talk and say, see you later. But I can tell you this, I'm not used to it. There's nothing within me that goes, oh, well, that's the way it happens. We're all going to die. There's something within us that tells us this is not right. This is not the way it's supposed to be. But the reality of our humanity is death. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50. Again, Paul has just given this whole thing on the resurrection. And that if there is no resurrection, then Christ didn't raise from the dead. And if Christ didn't raise from the dead, then your faith is in vain. And if your faith is in vain, then you need to party and live it up because you're living a useless life. But he says this, the resurrection is real. But there's no way you can get to be with the Lord in these bodies that we have. So he says this. Verse 50, I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. There's a transformation that needs to take place. You want to see the Lord, there's a transition. Now, the old people, my grandmother used to say this, when someone was dying, she would say, baby, they're transitioning. What a great word. You see, from this earthly life to this experience of eternal life, there is a transition. And Paul's going to talk about that in a moment. Let me keep going. This process is what we call death. So let's look at number two. Not only the reality of our humanity, but the certainty of our victory. That's number two, the certainty of our victory. This is the resurrection. Go back to 1 Corinthians 15, look at verse 51. Now he's already said, you're not going to get to heaven, you're not going to be with God in these bodies. You have to put on immortality. You have to put on that which is not perishable. And he says, verse 51, behold, I tell you a mystery. Now, this mystery is not like how we solve mysteries today and you put pieces together. No, this is the word for secret. This is something that had been hidden, but now it's revealed. So he's almost like this. I'm going to tell you a secret. Now, it was hinted toward in the Old Testament, but I'm going to tell you this mystery. We shall not all sleep. What in the world does that mean? We shall not all sleep, but I can tell you this. We shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet, the shofar will be blown. The trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and we shall be changed. Number one, there is the certainty of transformation. This is the mystery. We shall not all sleep. There's an event that's going to take place. And when this event takes place, some of you, and I'm speaking in Paul's words, some of you might still be alive when this happens, and you'll never experience death. You're not going to sleep. But some people who have already fallen asleep, they're going to be changed. But we're all going to be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, faster than you can blink your eye. That last trumpet, the shofar, the ram's horn, that horn that will gather God's people, that horn that would gather them for battle, that horn that would be blown to bring people to hear from God, there's going to be one last trumpet blown, and all of a sudden, all God's people are going to gather together. Some of them will be alive. Some of them will already have fallen asleep, but they will all be changed. In the moment, in the twinkling of eye, there is a certainty of transformation. Number two, there is the certainty of Christ returning. That's all in this verse. We shall not all sleep. We shall all be changed. In the moment, the trumpet will sound and Christ will return. He's coming back. And when he comes back, we're going to be transformed. I've been thinking about heaven a lot lately because, I don't know, maybe there's a series brewing when I'm thinking about what is heaven really like? Because the way that, and I've mentioned this, the way we portray it, it seems boring. The way we portray heaven is just like, I mean, only certain kind of people with certain kind of personalities would like it. Those who don't like to do anything and like to sit around and float on clouds and play harps. I don't know who they are. But I still want to live. I still want to create. I still want to laugh and sing and play games and have relationships with people. Won't that be heaven? with Jesus. Without the presence of sin, there is a certainty Christ is going to return. And then there's the certainty of victory. There is a certainty of victory. The trumpet will sound, the dead in Christ will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Look at verse 54. When the perishable puts on imperishable, and the mortal puts on what?
Immortality,
then shall come to pass the saying that is written, and this was written back in Isaiah, death is swallowed up in victory. It is the idea that death has been swallowed and wholly digested by victory. I love verse 55. Oh, death, where's your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. Here's what happened. Christ invaded death's domain and robbed it of its sting. Jesus went to the enemy's own territory and won the victory. To put it in basketball terms, Christ showed up and showed out. He beat him on his own court. He won. And in a sense, Paul is taunting. He's using words to taunt death. You've been swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? He's taunting death. I saw this type of taunting take place. I hate to keep talking about Ryland's basketball team, but I'm in the middle of it. So this is just where you have to live with me. We're at this game. This was last Sunday. Playing over at Glencliff High School, right in this neighborhood. They're playing, won their first game, second game. This is a tough team. I mean, they look tough. The parents look tough. Everybody was looking tough. And I mean, and they were tough. They were winning this, dominating this basketball game. And as they were dominating the game, the parents were displaying it as well. So when even one of our team members got up to shoot a free throw, the parents were taunting. He missed a free throw. Do it again. Do it again. And when he missed, one of the parents went like this. Yeah. I'm like, sit down. They were so assured of their victory. What were they doing? They were taunting. They were celebrating. In the same sense, this is the tone. This is the tone that Paul has when he's talking about death. Our victory is so sure, he's saying, death, where is your sting? Where is your victory? He's saying, sin doesn't win. It's been destroyed. Christ restores. We have victory in death. We have victory in life. We have victory over sin. In a sense, Paul is saying, so what else you got? What do you got left, death? He has nothing left. Church family, you see, death is not a period. It's a comma. It's not a period. It's death doesn't have the final say. I love Colossians 2, verses 13 through 15. And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses. What happened? By canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Christ did it all, and he triumphs in victory. There are so many other verses. Isaiah 25, I alluded to this earlier, verse 8. He swallowed up death forever. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. Hosea 13, 14, I shall ransom them from the power of Sheol. I shall redeem them from death. O death, where are your plagues? O Sheol, where is your sting? Compassion is hidden from my eyes. Over and over and over. Let me give you a couple more. Revelation chapter 20, verse 14. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is a second death. Revelation 21, 4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Church family, this is great victory. You have a certainty of your victory. Let me give you my last point. And I know you're thinking, what? We're at the end? Well, almost. Don't get too happy. Whenever a pastor says he's on his last point, it could go on for another hour. I won't. There's the reality of our humanity. It's death. The certainty of our victory. But then, number three, the activity of our victory. Now, what do I mean by that? The activity of our victory. How should you respond in light of the fact that you are victorious? Verse 57. But thanks be to God. First off, you should be very grateful. Let's just stop right there. But thanks be, you should be the most grateful people in the world. Whenever I see Christians who are filled with complaints, I'm going, you're not living the resurrected life. You're complaining, but what you don't see, that your heart should be overflowing with thankfulness. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So your heart should be one of gratitude. Verse 58, therefore, this is how we should live. Therefore, my beloved brother, be steadfast. That means to stand inwardly fast, absolutely fixed, even in the midst of instability. This is not stubbornness. This is not self-centeredness. This is standing fast on the fact that you have already won the victory. Live that way. When everything else is shaky in this world, live the victorious life. Be immovable, firmly persistent. Then it says, always abounding. That's super abundant in the work of the Lord. And we're to have this confidence, knowing that the Lord, in the Lord, your labor is not in vain. We have the victory, church. We have the victory. He will change, not only change us later, but he's changing us now. We are so victorious that some of you, when we were singing the song, I can't even remember the title now, but Lauren was singing it, and she said, I was a wretch. We don't even use that word anymore. But let me tell you, you were a wretch. I don't even have to know you. You were a wretch, but Christ came in. And if you've trusted him, he changed you, and he is changing you. This is the victory that we experience. Not only can I give you my testimony, there's the testimony of many of you here. I want you to watch the screen as we see how Christ has given us the victory. I want you to celebrate. I want you to read. I'm giving you a precursor of what's about to happen. I want you to be engaged. I want you to see what's happening. I want you to celebrate what's happening. And then I want us to end by declaring our victory in Christ. Let's watch the screen.
Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle beyond. victory for the